So now we have an other Italy. This is a session dedicated to different parts. Actually, I think we have here three continents of sorts. I just want to preface the first paper by saying that we at the Institute about 6-7 years ago did a 30-minute documentary series of interviews on survivors and the son and daughter of survivors of the Dalmati. And it's very moving, and I'll look for it in the next day or so that if anyone's interested, I'll look for the link. Yeah, so you can take at it. Yeah, it's really, really moving, and they're all in this area. So they're in this area, the New York, greater New York metropolitan area. So, and of course, the most famous of this group is Lidia Bastianich, who has become superseded just about everyone else in Italian cuisine. So our first speaker is Diego LAZZARICH.
Thank you, Anthony Tamburri. Thank you. Well, my presentation will focus on one aspect of an Italian diaspora widely neglected. The diaspora that I refer to started in 1943, reached its peaks in 47 and 54, fading out until its end in 1960. During this time, the very great majority of the Italian ethnic groups left their homes in Venezia Giulia and Dalmatia, or Istria, Fiume and Dalmatia, spreading all over Italy and in the rest of the world. What happened during this time was a real exodus. Esodo was the term used by those migrants, and of around 300,000 people. 300,000 people. Due to political conjunctures, this huge diaspora underwent a deep silencing that affected the Italian public opinion and academic research. Well, my paper will analyze the main reasons that led to this public silence and the complex relation between preservation and obliteration of memory that the exiled had to face in Italy until 2004. The geographical areas involved with the diasporic events are parts of the so-called Venezia Giulia, the city of Zara, and some islands of the Dalmatian coast, the areas in the red oval there. That's Venezia Giulia and parts of Dalmatia. The current geographical situation of these areas, today divided into three states, Italy, Slovenia, and Croatia, is the outcome of one of the many territorial redefinitions in Europe in the aftermath of World War II. Specifically, the Italian situation was decided by the peace treaties signed on the 10th of February 1947 in Paris among Italy and several other countries, including Yugoslavia, at that time Yugoslavia. As we can see, before the Paris treaties, the entire Venezia Giulia and the city of Zara were under the domain of the Kingdom of Italy. Things, however, are a little more complicated, yes, because this geographical partition actually dated back to 1919, when after World War I, Italy had acquired the Venezia Giulia territories from the Austro-Hungarian Empire. The city of Fiume became officially Italian just in 1924. The very point is that all these Adriatic regions have always been border zones, fluctuating from one political domain to another, from ancient to modern times. But despite the continuous political changes throughout history, these areas were for centuries a meeting point of different cultures and ethnicities, where different peoples lived together peacefully. That's the point. Different people lived together peacefully. Among these peoples, there were groups culturally and linguistically related to Italy. Well, things changed in these regions when the rise of nationalism, with the rise of nationalism in the 19th century, and got still worse with the rise of fascism in 1922, because, as the Italian historian Emilio Gentile claims, fascism promoted a concept of nation as synonymous of homogeneous ethnic community. The spaces where this ethnic homogeneity was threatened was in those regions that had become Italian recently and where no Italian minorities lived. Venezia and Giulia soon acquired a very high symbolic relevance for fascism. And in this area, we can see the manifestation of what has been called fascismo di confine, border fascism. A hard politics of Italianization, aiming at decreasing the relevance of the Slavic minorities, for instance, forbidding the use of Slovenian and Croatian languages, as you can see here. It's forbidden to speak Slavic, these languages, but also committing violent crimes and persecutions. As historian Anna Maria Vinci claims, the full Italianization of Venezia Giulia became a means to prove the force of the regime to the rest of Italy, and an issue to corroborate the identity of fascism itself. For this very reason, Venezia Giulia became a place highly associated to Mussolini's regime. After fascism collapsed, the new prime minister, Badoglio, signed an armistice with the Allied forces on the 8th of September, 1943. Soon the Italian Eastern Adriatic territories became a battlefield between the Nazi and the Yugoslav partisans led by Marshal Josip Broz, called Tito. What happened during this advance of these partisans is one of the dark pages of European history. Fierce retaliations against the Italian population were carried out all over the territories under the control of Tito, and hundreds of innocent people were murdered. Among these, I want to report the emblematic case of Norma Cossetto, a 23-year-old Istrian girl that was arrested by the communist partisans, raped and killed on the 5th of October, 1943. She, as many other people, was killed in a way that quickly became sadly famous. Groups of around 20 prisoners were lined in two and tied together with iron strings. During the night, prisoners were brought on the edge of a natural sinkhole, and there they were shot and thrown into the hole. This natural sinkhole, typical of the Calf's region, are called foibe, and soon became the symbol of the persecution of the Italians by the Yugoslav partisans. Terrified by what was happening, many Italians started to leave, to find new safe places. The fleeing became still more intense when retaliations continued even after the end of the World War II. Once the territories were under the full control of the Socialist Republic of Yugoslavia. Some pictures taken in 43 and 45. What was happening proved the existence of a clear political strategy carried out by the Yugoslav government to eliminate the presence of the Italian people. In order to claim the annexation of ethnically homogeneous territory once seated at the Paris Conference in Paris. And that's what happened 2 years later, on the 10th of February 1947. Once in Paris, Italy had to cede to Yugoslavia most of Istria, including the provinces of Fiume, Rijeka, Russian translation of Fiume, Zara, Pola, and the most of Gorizia. The Italian people that had not escaped yet from their homes had to face a dramatic choice, l'opzione between Italian or Yugoslav citizenship. the first meant to remain Italian, but to leave their land. The second meant to remain at home, but in an unwelcoming and frightful socio-political environment. The collective answer to this question was to leave, lasciare. And this was an answer related, yes, to a matter of safety, but still more important, a matter of identity. These people wanted to remain Italian, as you can see on l'Arena di Pola del 4 luglio 1946. Reliable sources estimate that between 250,000 and 300,000 people left from 1943 to 1954, the 75% of the total population. So unfamiliar had become that land to most of the Italians that some people left, taking away from the cemetery even the coffin of a family member. They brought it away. At the same time, we know from several interviews that many went away keeping inside the hope of returning home. Ritorneremo. At this point, Italy, widely destroyed by the war just ended, had to manage the huge number of displaced people coming from Venezia Giulia. 109 refugee camps were created all along the country, and here people could live together, speak their dialects, and celebrate their sense. In one phrase, people lived in these small communities where they could keep the original identity alive, despite difficulties and poverty. However, in general, the social cultural context was not a good humus to preserve this identity. The Italian general public was quite indifferent. And the public politically linked to the Italian Communist Party, the largest in Western Europe, was openly hostile. I will report one famous case which is highly significant. On the 16th of February 1947, a group of exiles coming by boat from Pola arrived in Ancona, and here they boarded on a cargo train to La Spezia. Okay. But once in Bologna, the train couldn't stop for food and drink because it was attacked by stones by militants of the Italian Communist Party. This dramatic episode happened because, according to many people linked to the Italian Communist Party, that was a train of fascists. Easy. As described by the journalist Tommaso Gio on L'Unità, most communists close to PC deeply believed that those people were fascists, and for this reason they were escaping from socialism. Stalin told to leader of the Italian Communist Party, Togliatti, to consider Tito as a friend and as a liberator. And so Togliatti did, as well as the people that believed or blindly believed in the leading function of the party. Things changed when Stalin broke with Tito in 1948, but it was too late. The idea of the equation exile equal fascists already had taken root in the common sense of the left. So everybody believed that they were fascists, and so it was. Furthermore, once Stalin broke with Tito, Yugoslavia suddenly became a potential ally for the Western states. Therefore, also the Italian government started avoiding to focus its attention to the political issues still open with Yugoslavia. All of these factors contributed to the denial of the memory of this diaspora. A denial that took place throughout various means. The lack of specific laws for the preservation of memory, the absence of public monuments, slow and meager compensation for the lost properties, the exclusion of the exodus from history books, we still have today, in part, etc. Thus, the Giuliano-Dalmata diaspora became a taboo, a negated event. Still worse, no one could speak about what happened without being accused of being fascist again. Therefore, the memory gradually disappeared from public debate. Words like nazione or patria were too old and dangerous in the new historical page of the Italian Republic and for the ongoing process of unfascistation. Unfascistizzazione. These words, however, were so meaningful to the exiled who had opted for Italy after being persecuted for their Italianness. In such a context, the preservation of the identity of the exile became a very, very difficult task. Or worse, something to leave behind in order to get accepted in the new socio-political and cultural Italian history. Everything indicated the direction of obliteration of memory and the need to create a new identity. The spiral of silence spread all over the public opinion. We know that the public silence in many cases became also personal and psychological silence. The internalization of public silence led to the inability of sharing the memory, to the point of madness in some cases. The preservation of memory from 1960 to 2000 was therefore taken up only by the few associations of exiled or small magazines, but this memory could be used only to keep alive a private identity of a restricted community that had no chance of being incorporated into the wider national Italian identity. Italy was rapidly losing the memory of that diaspora, and with it also that page of history. With the end of the Cold War and the overcoming of the ideological oppositions within Italian and international politics, this page in history could begin to be recovered. In 2004, the Parliament approved the Giorno del Ricordo, the Day of Remembrance, with the aim of making the history of one part into the history of the entire Italian Republic. The day in which Italy signed the Paris Peace Treaties, 10th of February, has become the day in which public ceremonies are held to remember the Exodus. Has this memory now become part of the national memory and identity? The answer is yes, but not totally. Because today we still have manifestations of opposition to the remembrance of the victims of the Foibe and of that diaspora. In several Italian cities, monuments have been vilified by anonymous supporters of the far-left political movement. As we can see, what happened around 70 years ago is still alive and operating in several processes of identity building. The construction of the identity of the exiled was and still is a continuous process of negotiation with cultural and political spheres. However, the complexity of this advance remarks how difficult it is to define the very concept of Italian identity and Italianness. What are the historical events that take part into the formation of this identity? Which geographical areas should be considered Italian? How does it change with time? Facing these questions, sometimes I get a little displaced, I have to confess, when I interview the exiled. Because they candidly tell me that they were ready to face all the difficulties of the diaspora because they were Italian and they just wanted to remain Italian. Grazie.
Our second speaker is Robert PASCOE. His biography, along with everyone else's, is in the program. The title of his paper is A World History Approach to the North End Italians.
So my talk is about the North End of Boston, one of the most documented neighborhoods in the history of the entire world. In fact, I can think of about 20 famous scholars who've made their name out of the North End, not including me. And because I've only got 20 minutes, I'm not going to play much of this tape. Just a little bit of this this tape to so you get the accent. My accent is actually Australian, so don't be confused.
But really?
I did my postdoc at Harvard. That's where I met Susan and Billy here when they come to hear my talk. And in 1982 and 1983, we had very limited resources really to understand Italian migration in this country because we didn't have the wonderful internet. We didn't have this wonderful access to electronic archives. And so what I've done subsequently in 2014 onwards is to go back to my filing cards. Remember filing cards? You ever have filing cards? Yeah. Phone cards and go back to the names of the people I looked at in 1982, 1983, and then look through ancestry.com and other sources to find out who they really were. And by that means work out their story. So the North End is famous for the tough guys. Tough guys are the young boys who inhabit this neighbourhood, who are the subject of lots of discussion by people like William Foote White, in his famous book, Three Corner Society. Many, many books talk about these people. They are, if you like, emblematic of a certain kind of working class culture, which is interesting for us as Australians as we enter into a kind of a similar kind of multicultural sort of life. So in this paper, I'm going to try three things. First of all, and very quickly, because Anthony will guard my time. Looking at my research very, very generally, particularly about the North End of Boston, to propose a method of study, local community study, which you can use in your own classrooms around the world, and to reframe this migration away from the filio-pietistic orientation of our ancestors, this ancestor worship that's so evident in the early Italian-American scholarship, towards what I would call a world history approach. And at Victoria University in Melbourne, I teach world history. I teach students the history of the world. And so I want to put these Italians, a particular group of people, inside that much bigger context to explain their lives and why they're so important, in fact, not just to Italians, but to all kinds of people. So you know that Italian migration takes three forms. You have circular migration, people who go off in search of work and come back to the farm, particularly the people like the Golondrini who go down to Buenos Aires and work on the pampas and go back to the villages of North Italy at the beginning of the new seasons in April. And I want to think of them in Deleuze-Guattarian terms as smooth immigrants, smooth in the sense of not belonging to boundaries, not belonging to spaces. And this, of course, always confused the American hosts of these people. They were anarchists. Sacco and Vanzetti come from this community because they were liquid. They didn't actually belong to containers. They flowed in and out of America. So Deleuze and Guattari, in their formulations about, in their book, A Thousand Plateaus, talk about these nomadic people as a really important element of contemporary society. There are now 100 million nomads in the world who move around. And you've got, I believe you've got a dangerous bunch of Hondurans coming your way, Anthony, at the moment. And then there's the compulsory migration. And this, in Guattari terms, would be striated people, people whose lives are controlled by others. And they are padrone-led migrations, led from the village. And then there's a third group, of course, a much more common group, who are delayed immigrants, who begin as smooth immigrants. So when you tell their story, we interview them, they talk about when they were first in America, and they were young, and they were free, and they were bold, and they were brave, and then their families came with them, and they had to settle into American life and become American, and they became regimented by American culture. In the case of the Boston Italians, that's World War II, when they put on their uniforms and go to fight in the Pacific and elsewhere for the US Army. So that's a combination of smooth and striated. That's the two groups, two kinds of styles of migration put together. And that's the most common form. Now, the problem with economic historians is that they confuse these groups together, run them together. And there's a famous article by Herbert Klein in the American Historical Review in 1983, which does this, which uses the census data to mix them all together. But they're not, they're different people, they're different, have different motivations, different attitudes, different stories. And so what I want to do is to pull them apart and understand how they actually belong to different stories and different kinds of migration. And I want to understand also the people who American historians have trouble with, people who actually don't stay in America. Why wouldn't you stay in America? This is the greatest country in the world, American historians think. Because that's why the American historians employed by American universities. But no, in fact, many of them go back to Italy or go on to other places like Canada or Latin America. For the Italian historians, of course, it was great this morning to hear that our friends in Genova, our new friends at the Museo there, are now moving towards a migration museum. Because up until very recently, Italian historians had no interest in these people. And my Italian friends in Australia feel provincial when they go to Italy. They feel like they are, just like I do when I go to London, and feel I'm reminded I'm an Australian, not an Englishman. They feel the same way. And so what's nice now is that the Italian historians are now dramatically adopting a lot of the conversation that we've begun here in America around these migration issues. And that's fantastic. And that's going to be a great conversation we have in June next year with our friends in Liguria. And finally, of course, I want to emphasise this world history aspect, this aspect which is really about where the story fits into the bigger picture. The North End survived, and that is in itself remarkable. It survived because the people of the North End had what Granovetter, in his famous article, calls the strength of weak ties. They were not a little village like the West End. When Herbert Gans wrote about the West End in his book Urban Villages, he was describing a village which was insular, cut off from the rest of the world. And so, of course, they lost out. When the powers that be in Boston wanted to redevelop Boston, they simply demolished the entire suburb and put there the world's most important and largest hospital, Mass General, which now sits on what was an immigrant neighbourhood. But round the corner in the North End survived. And it survived because of this multiplicity of weak ties. It had links across Boston into the Kennedy political establishment, into the Irish establishment, into all of the other bits that make up Boston. And survived and thrives today. It's still a living, breathing neighbourhood. It had been a place of migration, important in the revolutionary period, important in the Gilded Age, obviously important for Irish migration, then became Little Italy. Four groups of Italians, the Genovese, the people from Avellino and the villages around Avellino and Campania, people from Sicily, particularly around Palermo, and the Abruzzese. These are the four main groups of Italians who move into the North End. And so what I wanted to do was to understand those migrations, their experiences in the North End, and then what happened to them after the North End. So to do that, we have to have, as I said, some kind of world history methodology. And the sample I took was from Hanover, which is the main street running through the spine of the North End. North End, I'll quickly show you, grows from its colonial origins into a big industrial area. And then from 1880, the Genovese is still here, but new groups of Italians are moving into the North End. And DeMarco, whose thesis is one of the pioneering theses of this area, documents, as you can see from these pictures, the changing mosaic of Italian migration in the North End. 2008, I was in Arezzo at the Festival of the Saracen and met this guy, Billy Venezia, and he said, "We're from the North End, but we're now living in Florida." I thought, that's curious. Here's a person who's a million miles from the North End, geographically, spatially, and every other way, and he still sees himself as a North Ender. And when you read obituaries in the Boston Globe, it'll usually begin, "So-and-so is a North Ender." You think, wow, that's weird. That was like 50 years ago. And yet that's the identity that's carried into the suburban experience of these people long after they've left the North End. So I want to understand how this happens. And to do that, I need to use this technique we call prosopography. Prosopography is based on the collection of data around a sample of people who have in common something. And these people have in common that their families lived in these tenements on Hanover Street between 1920 and 1954. And so this is an area owned by the Kennedys. And so the lists are very accurate because the Kennedy ward bosses needed to know who's there, who's going to support Honey Fitz and then his wonderful family married into the Kennedys and gave you a great president. And so this is the data. These are the lists of people that come from these city directories. This is now all available online, and some amazing work done at Tufts and elsewhere using this data. It's very rich data. It shows that it gives names to the people, their occupation, their presumed age, and where they were 5 years earlier. Okay, so you're beginning to see some fabulous data. If only you can somehow sift it, sort it, make it work for you. And of course, with the with our knowledge about Italian culture, we can do that. We can see that if it says Bevilacqua, they don't mean what says on the board, they mean Bevilacqua. And so we can put that back into Italian, we can understand it, and we can actually locate that Bevilacqua family back where they came from in Italy. So the sample, then uses these cognomi, and it goes back into the town histories in Italy of these people. And it also uses other sources, particularly printed sources, Calavalli's Americans of Italian descent, published 1946. You can use the local church records, you can use the local military records, which give you all the data that you want in terms of working out bits of their lives. And this chart here shows you the sort of the methodology tracing from ancestry.com through into different kinds of resources down to you get the final outcome. So let me just hand out now because I am a teacher. I have to have a handout, Anthony. Sorry, I can't do that handout. Okay. This handout gives you a sample of some of the names of some of the people that I'm looking at, and it shows you how we sift and sort this data across the different columns. The column on the left gives you a cognome, the household head, who can be a woman, it's not necessarily a male. And then the second column gives you the town they come from in Italy, down to the paesino, down to the frazione in some cases, depending on how much data is available in the genealogical records. And then the transition, how they came to America. We heard about Ellis Island this morning. These folks are often coming through Boston directly, not coming through Ellis Island, and that inflects their understanding of America. And then their occupation at the time living in the North End. So the Sicilians are typically fishermen or in the fishing industry. The people from Campania are usually self-employed. They're running the cafes. They've brought some capital with them. They've got some sort of purchase in this new economy. And the people from other parts of Italy have a range of jobs ranging from professional work, a number of physicians, pastors, all the way across to carpenters, labourers, and so on. And then the next column tells you where they went, what we call secondary migration, where they go after the North End. And then the final one tells you what their descendants are doing today, their children and grandchildren are doing today. So this is a very helpful set of data. And so once we know this, we can then begin to test some of the most important questions about America as a place of opportunity. So why they left Italy? Well, we can work it out because we know from their time of departure and where they came from, the various ripple effects of the risorgimento across Italy and the ways in which different parts of Italy are affected unevenly by the process of Italian unification. We can get some sense of their experience of the North End from lots of sources, including some of the local sources. We can know a bit about their secondary migration. We can know a bit about where they fit into the big story of world history. Italy, as you know, was going through enormous convulsions. One of the towns in which people come, Monte Falciano, had a very important revolt in 1861. Lots of people were killed. And so there's a lot of brigandage, a lot of riot, a lot of revolt against this process of unification. And so these people we're talking about are the early victims, if you will, of that domination of the Italian South by the North. And Pinocchio, as you know, is invented as before Disney got to him and made him unpolitical, he was actually a very important figure. He was a symbol of what was wrong with Italy. It was a constructed person. It wasn't a fun thing, it was a bad thing. And we see also that other parts of the American story fit into this, that Genoa provides us with Italian settlers in San Francisco. So it's two-fifths of Italians in Fisherman's Wharf are from our new friends in Genoa. We're going to meet next June. Yeah, it's a really important story. So when we go to Genoa, we're going to see bits of San Francisco without knowing it, and bits of Boston. We're going to see that they come by different means. The people from Genoa came into the North End, did not stay, moved into the suburbs of Boston, we call Dorchester, which is the south west corridor of Boston, running through Dorchester Heights, down past Roxbury, if you know a bit of Boston. Affluent area, a lot of, in fact, developed by Italian workers in the 1930s. Sicilians and Campanians travelling directly, they are travelling in groups, they have an agenda, they have padroni, they are led by people, and the Sicilians moving together do not achieve social mobility. They are part of Thunstrom's other Bostonians. They are the people who miss out. They are the people who are, the victims of the fact that America, despite its rhetoric, remains a class society. So they come into the North End, they're in a moment of fluidity, and then they are reinserted by the economic forces into occupations which trap them into low-paid jobs, in particular the fishing industry, particularly up in Gloucester, the northern part of Massachusetts. Here's a famous photograph from William Hine. Once I've told you the background, you can sort of see that here is it's a beautiful documentation of a young boy selling fish with his dad and his uncle on the Tea Wharf before they move out of the North End and go up into the northern part of Massachusetts. The Bushlaki family, very important fish industry, and that's a very typical story of a family-run business which becomes part of the North End mythology, and you'll see recorded again and again by the local historians. They come back to the North End for their Madonna del Soccorso festival. So this festival has become a really important way of these people reconnecting with the North End and reclaiming, reasserting, owning their identity as Sicilians. Madonna del Soccorso festival started in 1910, including a blessing of the fleet, then going into the modern times as a major moment of remembrance by these folks. Other Sicilians, for example, Campanians, the famous, you've probably eaten here, the Vittoria Cafe on Hanover, classic story of success. But moving out of Mifford, spelt Medford, pronounced by us Bostonians as Mifford, don't know why. Brogna becomes the first employee of the Boston Council. Other shop owners of Bravoca, these are shop businesses which continue today. And so Stop and Shop, for example, some could know, begins in the North End and goes out into other parts of Boston. Nice story here. This is a guy becomes a school custodian. But his important thing is that he's actually active in the VFW, the Veterans of Foreign Wars. He becomes part of his American story begins a service in the World War II. Other people going out into white-collar suburbs, like people from Avellino, Malden, Cambridge, Belmont. In those days, Somerville was poor, it's no longer poor. Arlington, again, quite wealthy. And their festival is St. Anthony of Padua. And that's how it starts, lighting up the street with these beautiful decorations. This is when I visited in 1982. I'm in that crowd there somewhere. We're taking the photograph. And then again, more recently, you can see here the Madonna, of course, are being carried. So forget Halloween. This is the real deal. And we can see that in this performance of the festival, they are actually retracing the steps of their ancestors. So we can track where they walk. We can see these are the areas of the North End where their grandfathers and grandmothers lived. Not like a typical festival of Italy, not like the festival of Arezzo, much more American. Dollar bills pinned to the fabric of the tunic of the... And then we can see also... in this, a place for the young men who create this new identity. And I want to conclude with just a couple of quick comments about the male adolescent gangs, who in Luzzaguattarian terms are classic nomadic war machines. They are groups of young men moving around. And last night we met a couple of those in the streets of Brooklyn, a couple of nomadic war machines moving around, causing trouble in Brooklyn. So these are part of the inner urban American experience, this idea of young kids, particularly males, out for the night. And you get this, if you go back to Palermo today, you'll see the same kids. They're second cousins in Palermo doing much the same thing as in Sicily. Some differences. The big difference is the Italian Americans lose their hands. They become amputated. They no longer use their hands. I was watching you this morning, Anthony. You've still got a bit of it, but you've really got to work on that. You know, you've really got to get your hands moving if you're going to be genuinely thought of as Italians by our Italian visitors. So this sort of these changes are taking place imperceptibly at times, but they are real. And there are changes of clothing, changes of manner, changes of health, diet, height, and so on. And the photographs from the North End are really quite important to understand this culture. Spoken language also important. There's quite a few sources that I'll quickly run through. And then, of course, food. And then, finally, the world history themes. I think really important issues. First of all, the survival of deocentric ideas in the anthropocentric world. The idea that there are these cosmic forces which are gestured at in the festivals. Secondly, the persistence of la cultura contadina, the peasant worldview. And although I joke about Halloween's a beautiful example of a European peasant tradition which has now gone global. And it's a really important festival. And finally, of course, the success of the US as a world power, the most powerful country in the history of the world. Far more powerful than any other culture you'd ever want to name, because it successfully integrates these dynamic people who are the Americans don't understand. They electrocute Sacco and Vanzetti. They don't kind of get them, but somehow the miracle occurs, and this process goes on, and we have this amazing American society. So we can use this, I think, in teaching. I think we can say to our students, no matter where you are, if you're in Peoria, Illinois, if you're in Montreal in Canada, you can take this approach, this methodology, and you can actually get your students to track real families across generations and understand where they fit into the larger story of the world history. Thank you very much.
Our third speaker is LARA PICCARDO, Italians in Crimea, a forgotten history of forgotten immigration, indeed, forgotten.
And yes, as my title said, I'm going through another and kind of Italianness, let's say. The one of Crimea that is quite, actually not a forgotten, it is true, maybe it is quite an unknown history. Yeah. Well, Crimea is, let's say, a border and crucial land between East and West. And because of its position, it knew and it knows a hard history of conflicts, but also wars, but also migrations. Let's say that the, let's say, Latin presence in Crimea started with the Roman Empire because there was there a military base of the Roman Empire founded by Pompeius Magnum, who was the rival of Julius Caesar's. Pompeius Magnum said, if you want the power, you must rule the sea. So this is the reason why he started to defend the Roman borders using, how can I say, the last possible sea known at those times. Then in the Middle Ages, there is a quite good, let's say, Italian or Genoese migration towards Crimea. This is known as the first migration from Liguria, more than Italy, towards the eastern part of Europe. At those times, Crimea was conquered by the Golden Horde of Mongol and Tatars. In the 13th century, merchants from Venice and Genova, the city that I come from, and the city that is going to host the third session of this symposium, established their little trade companies. It was possible because as a part of the so-called Mongolian Pax, Crimea had become a commercial and transit center for goods shipped from China to West. The Genoese business there soon removed the Venetian one because on 1261, the first captain of the people, the Genoese Guglielmo Bocca Negra, and the Byzantine Emperor Michael VIII signed the Treaty of Nymphaeum. The agreement gave to the Republic the possibility to give an all-out war to the Venetian presence there, and give also to the Genoese center there the possibility to have the complete absolute right to ship goods from China to West. On the Greek side, the Genoese were guaranteed to the exclusivity navigation also on the Black Sea. So it is the reason why in Crimea also at the moment there are a lot of Italian surnames, such as, for example, Negra, Negri, De Negri, that are of Genoese origins, because thanks to that right, a lot of people coming from Genova moved in Crimea in order to do the things that they were very good in doing, that is, make trade and, shipping goods from east to west. The cohabitation between the Genoese and the Mongol majority unfortunately ended at the end of the 14th century because the Genoese tried to be very strong against Mongols and to try to have a big area politically controlled by the Genoese Republic. So they crashed into a war, and the Genoese political power there were defeated by the Mongol Tatars. But they remained there as a very important trade center. And we can say that several descendants from that first Italian migration are still in Crimea at the moment. Then at the beginning, I cannot talk about the history of Crimea, obviously. The only thing that I would like to know, that you know, is that in 1787, thanks to an agreement between the Khan and the Queen of Russia, Catherine the Great, Crimea passed without any war into Russian control, and it became a Russian land. At the beginning of the 19th century, there is a second Italian migration toward Crimea because Russian emissaries sent to the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies, that is the southern part of Italy, were tasked with presenting the formal invitation of the Tsar Alexander I and recruiting as many more farmers and artisans as possible in order to develop Crimea. The invitation was appreciated, and so we have a second migration from the southern part of Italy, in this case, to Crimea. A proof of this migration is in the Roman Catholic Church of Kerch, that was a Genoese city founded by the Genoese with the name Italian name Cerchio. And this Roman church was built by the Piedmontese architect Alessandro Digby. And it was the siege, let's say, of almost 30 Italian families in Crimea. Then we have a third Italian migration toward Crimea just after the Crimean War. So it means more or less around 1856-1858. In this case, the migration involved especially Italian people coming from the northern part of Italy. They were mainly sailors, fishermen, astronomy pilots, captains, and shipbuilding workers. So probably also Giuseppe Garibaldi's cousins went in Crimea, establishing his family in Feodosia, where at the moment there are several families having the surname Garibaldi. Then there is a fourth Italian migration after 1861, because it is a very important year in the history of the two countries. It is the year of the Italian unification, but it is also the year in Russia of the emancipation of serfs. And so the poor people of the former kingdom of the Two Sicilies was submitted to economic and social policy of Piedmont, which was not able, maybe in that moment, as we see before with Pinocchio, to construct an integrated state or an integration between northern and southern part of Italy. On the other hand, in Russia, state lands were to be sold because of the lack of farmers. So the two conditions are the premises of this fourth migration towards Crimea. The question is, how many are these those Italians, and where they come from? Well, my sources speak about 2,000 people, more or less. In the answer to a question given in the Italian Parliament Foreign Affairs Committee on the 17th of September 1997, it is stated that the Italians would have settled in Crimea since the 18th century, as I said, mainly in the cities of Kerch and Feodosia, coming, and I'm quoting, essentially from Campania, Puglia, as well as from Liguria and other Tyrrhenian regions. Actually, I have to say that data are very difficult to be interpreted at the moment because some Italians came back to Italy, others Russified their names. Some families claim a different regional origins, but it's difficult to prove. Sometimes there are families saying we are coming from the southern part of Italy, but a genealogist study can prove that the name is of the northern part of Italy. So at the moment, there is a little bit of mess in order to rebuild the real, let's say, history of this family. The story of this small Italian community is also linked to another important part of Russian history, that is the one of communist, obviously. So we have to say that starting from the beginning of the Soviet Union history around 1922 and starting from the birth of the Italian Communist Party the year before, so it means 1921, we have the last Italian migration towards Crimea. That is the genuine political migration from Italy to Crimea. We have to say that already in that moment, the Italian migration founded his little Italy in Crimea. And the name is obviously expressed in Russian. It is the Italianskaya Obshchina. And at the moment, they refer to themselves as an Obshchina, that is a kind of community, not a kind of, it is a community. So, beginning from 1922 and 1924, with the arrival of the Italian political emigrants, the Italian Communist Party took care, especially of the Kerch community. And everything was up to the Committee for Emigration of the Italian Communist Party. In 1924, it is interesting, the initiative of this man. He is Anselmo Marabini. He was a communist deputy. He found out the way to build an agricultural cooperative, that is a kolkhoz. The kolkhoz took the name of Sacco and Vanzetti in order to remember the Italian anarchists Nicola Sacco and Bartolomeo Vanzetti were executed here in the United States. The kolkhoz was founded, it is interesting, with the support, obviously, of the government of the Soviet Union, but with the complete unhappiness of the Italianskaya Obshchina, because Italians were Catholic landowners, shipbuilders, and so the communist movement in that moment, in that period in Crimea, was not well accepted. So those who can leave Crimea and came back to Italy. And we have to say that starting from this from that moment, the numbers of the Italians in Crimea started to decrease. In the 20s, the population, the Italian population in Crimea is up to 1.3% percentage of the total population of the province of Kerch. Then, at the end of the 90s, of the 20s and the beginning of the 30s, the situation worsened again. Stalin started with the purges and repression, and in that period many Italians were accused of being Italian spies. In Italy there was the fascism regime, so a new kind of international relation between the two countries started, and the Italians paid also this issue. We have also to say that in Russia, in that moment, there was also the idea of the public enemy of the state. So all those who were not Russian, more than communist, were to, how can I say, controlled, arrested, or worst. During the Second World War, Crimea was conquered by the Wehrmacht, that is the German army, and a lot of minorities in Crimea was very happy of receiving the Germans, welcoming them as liberators, so for as freedomers. So for that reason, the coming back of the Red Army in Crimea, there was a kind of, let's say, revenge from the Soviet Union against that national minorities. So it means that starting from 1944, the national minorities in Crimea, so also the Italian one, were deported as populations declared fascist, being helpful for the Wehrmacht. About the Italian minority in Crimea. Here you can see the path of the deportation. I'm not going to talk about this long trip. As you can imagine, it was a difficult one, and a lot of people died during the deportation. Obviously, it is also difficult to understand the numbers of men and women that had that travel, because the passports and all the official documents were kept by the Soviet authorities. So it's very difficult to have now a clear situation of that minority. According to a rough estimate, we can state that following the deportation, more than 500 Italians of Crimea perished tragically. After Stalin's death and after the de-Stalinization, let's say, some already deported Italians managed to return to Crimea and especially to Kerch, and so others in the following year, thanks also to the Khrushchev initiative of denouncing the Stalinist crimes. Once communism fell in the Soviet Union and the Soviet Union dismantled, independence was regained by Ukraine, and Crimea started to become an autonomous republic. So the ancient minorities expelled from the territories during this period tried, in part, to come back to Crimea and reorganize themselves. From 1992 and 1997, the Italian embassy in Ukraine received 47 applications for reacquisition of Italian citizenship. Only two were positive, according to the last 1992 Citizenship Act. Currently, the Italians in Crimea, at least those who declare themselves Italians, are more than 400, centralized mainly in Kerch and in Simferopol, that is Crimea capital. They are organized in different associations. One of them is the Italian Association Terchio, community of emigrants in the region of Crimea, Italian of origin, which was founded on the 28th of July 2008 in Kerch, and unites more or less the descendants of Italian immigrants. With the annexation of Crimea to Russia, the Association of the Italians of Crimea continues to work to rebuild a census of Italian in peninsula, which is a very strong effort, and it is a work still in progress because of the difficulties that I already talked a bit during my presentation. So thank you very much for your patience and for listening to this, how can I say, long travel through this minority.
My question starts with Rob, but also extends to the other two. Rob, you didn't get a chance really at the end to talk about the idea of world history and how immigrant flows, the Italian immigrant flows, would fit within that revisioning. Can you say a few words about that? And then to the other two, how would that idea impact the work you're doing? Might it shift the way you're thinking about the Crimean and the Yugoslav Italians? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Susan. Yeah, I guess the difference between world history and other kinds of history is essentially that other kinds of history are typically national histories, and immigrants don't fit into national containers very easily, in the same way that neither do minorities of various kinds. And so a world history, for example, of the Afro-American experience would be very different from the histories of Black America that you've read so far. It would talk about Africa. It would talk about identities as Africans. It would talk about the Middle Passage as an ordeal. It would then talk about the movement of Afro-Americans inside the American economy as the American economy changes. And so it would, in a way, it would subvert a lot of the traditional categories and periodizations and who are the heroes and who are not the heroes. And so it would relegate certain people to obscurity, who you might think are very important in the story, and others who you didn't know about would suddenly become more prominent. So what world history does, in a way, is it reevaluates how we write history. History as a profession, as an academic profession, of course, begins in the period of nation building in the 19th century. It begins as a way of extolling the virtues of being German or being British or American. It says, no, these categories don't make sense in a global age. And so the courses that some of you have done at college in the 60s called The Rise of the West have been totally rewritten by historians and now introduce elements like the importance of Islam, the importance of other traditions in the world, not just the West, the traditions coming out of the Middle East, coming out of East Asia, and also coming out of the subaltern groups such as the south of Italy. So it reworks history completely. And for my students, I teach at a blue-collar working-class university where the students have never had parents at university. For them, this is a natural way of doing history. They've grown up as Croatians, or they've grown up as Chinese or as Muslims. And so for them, they want to know about where their family story fits into, not Australian history, which they regard as an artificial category, but rather into the history of Islam or the history of Calabrese or whatever it might be.
Yes, I think that global history, world history, is quite useful in order to understand migrations. Also because they are a very long, path in history. Crimea is definitely a nice example of that because there are a lot of waves of migration starting from several thousand years before Christ. And you can see, or we can see, that there are people moving from east to west to east, and then coming back, leaving their presence in Crimea, that is actually a borderland. Then I like very much the concept of the global history up to now, because it is quite important to have, yes, a national glance to a national identity, but inside a bigger world. For example, sometimes I really appreciate to talk about, yes, migrations in general more than Italian, French, American, or Arabs migration, because talking about them from a national perspective, it seems to be important to build a specific point of view against another kind of point of view. And I don't like it so much. For example, this morning we had a brilliant presentation about the Italian migration in France. Up to me that I'm really interested in the European integration process. It was a little bit difficult, not to appreciate, I don't want to say that, but leave it just as a national migration into another European countries and into another European, member. So I think that the idea of the national migration are an idea built quite now in order to maybe sometimes make several comparison between former migration and actual or present migrations, but maybe we should or we must overcome them towards a world history in order to be more, more patient in evaluating the very big waves of migration. I don't know if it was clear enough. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question. Well, I have to be honest. Maybe I don't know enough about world history to say I don't use this approach, so I cannot tell. You could tell us. But what I can say from my perspective, partially as an historian as well, history has always a point of view. Has always a point of view. Somebody that tells you something. From the birth of historiography, from the beginning of the Greek historiography, if you read to Herodotus, you say, okay, just tell the facts. But the facts were Greek facts. When you go to Roman historiography, you read Livy, you just say, hey, come on, guys, history is good for politics. So we tell a discourse in Foucauldian terms. So what's word history? What's its point of view? I don't know. Of course, as usual, if you take this perspective, you just say, okay, maybe it's what's global history from where the US maybe? a superpower. So I can't really tell. But if, to me, as always, history is always a matter of taxonomic order. Something is more relevant than other. So it depends on what's your spot, what's your position in the world. So what do you think that matters more than something else? But if we just mean maybe with this approach, something that you look from, from a farther distance, you put some distance between you, it could be very useful because this page of history was just, you have struggled, many struggles we see between historians, Italian and Yugoslav historians. We don't even know the numbers of the exodus, of the Lesotho. We don't know. Because Italians say, okay, 300, 500, and Yugoslav historians say, no, they're just few thousand people. So maybe if we take this, you take the first part of my answer, but if we take this perspective, maybe it could be useful, and it is useful because this was a very huge, and no matter how you look at it, it was just many villages that just emptied, just many people went away, and maybe perspective, from a certain distance, you have people went all over the world. In Italy, but they went to the U.S. Anthony mentioned Lydia Bastianich. Hundreds of people came here in Argentina, Brazil, Venezuela, Australia. I was there last year. You have hundreds of people. They're very active community. South Africa, you have Istrians all over. So maybe if we would. Honestly, that's what I'm trying to do in a certain way. I'm trying to start a project to look from several perspectives. Because it can help, because in Italy, this is still a hot topic. You can talk very easily about that. I mean, you always risk to be accused of being a fascist, which is, to me, is so.
I have a remark for Diego LAZZARICH, whose passionate defense of the exodus of Istrian people I appreciated very much. Also because being a very old person, I had an occasion to see some of this. I used to live in Friuli in the post-war period, so I also have personal experiences. But I think that the terrible episode, because it was a tragic episode of the post-war period, must be seen, speaking of world history, within a very complex pattern of historical facts, which belong to the post-war period, but were also the result of what fascism was in Italy and outside Italy. And without appreciating all these elements, you do not understand why there were uncertain, complex, or negative reactions to this exodus and to the situation of the people from Istria, some from Dalmatia, etc. First of all, I want to stress that the layer of Italianity of those people was very old, partially very old, because Venice had owned the area, Istria and Dalmatia, for many, many centuries. It had owned the areas, it had exploited the areas, because of course it used the woods of those areas and the stone. The Istrian stone was, you can see the Istrian stone all over Venice. I mean, Venice is built with Istrian stones. So there were a lot of people who lived there and worked for Venice and within the Venetian trade operations. But we must remember that during the fascist, the famous ventennio, the 20 years of fascism that we lived in Italy, the fascistization of Istria and as well as other areas occupied by the Italians was very strong, and the repression was terrible. Not only so, but fascism supported the extreme right wing of the Croatian, the Ustasha. And this created mass murders, which people did not forget. And against the Ustasha and against the fascists, there were Tito's partisans who very heroically withdrew to back into the Balkans and then fought back through the whole of Yugoslavia. And so you can understand how the reaction was a reaction against enemies. They saw enemies. Then during the fascist period, the fascistization brought a lot of Italians into this area. Italians who were brought there, not only the old Italians were traditionally, who had been living there for centuries maybe, but new Italians, like, you know, likewise it happened in other areas, or as it happened in Africa, in Ethiopia, where the Italians were brought within the imperial policy of fascism. So the reaction must be seen in this very complex pattern, and must also understand that you mentioned the policy of the Communist Party. And here I would specify that the Communist Party at that point was a strict ally of Tito, not only because of ideological reasons and because they were part of the same international, but because both the Yugoslav Party and the Italian Party were very much aside from the Russian Communist Party. In fact, as you might know, I'm sure you know about it, later on Tito detached himself from the Internazionale, and the Italian Communist Party opened up an entirely new way, which was never approved and was in conflict with the Russian. So Tito's policy and the Italian Communist Party's policy were very much akin. So the approach of the Communist Party to all this was understandable. But the fact that the refugees from Istria were not received as they should have been was not the responsibility of the Communist Party, because the Communist Party was not ruling then. I mean, the government was a Christian Democrat government immediately after the war, after 48. So, I mean, this cannot be ascribed to the responsibility of the Italian Communist Party. And finally, what was I wanted to say? And I also wanted to add something which, of course, everybody might imagine, that in the post-war period, Italy was in a catastrophic state. I mean, it was bombed all over, north and south, a lot of homeless people. All the people, the soldiers who had been imprisoned by the Germans in the Balkans, they were 700,000, and you know, deported to Germany and kept as IMI, Italian military internati militari italiani, without being recognized the status of war prisoners. So the situation was chaotic and very difficult. So you must put this element into a general pattern of great difficulty.
Okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you for your question and for the points. Maybe I'm sorry, because I thought I did in a way. I mean, I spent 3 minutes to talk about fascism and the way he persecuted Slavians in Slovenia and Croatia and all. And you know why I did? Because I agree with you. If we talk about what happened, that diaspora, I think that's the right way to approach. You can say, you know, there were 1,000 people that were persecuted by Tito's partisans, and that's it. No. That's not what I do. That's not the way I see it. I think it is right to frame it, to put a frame, historical framework. That's it, but it doesn't mean that these things didn't happen. The things happen. There was a reason? Yes, of course, there's always a reason. But so, well, I think, you know, sometimes you say, okay, so we justify what happened. We have to justify the murder. No, you know, I'm not saying so. No, this is not my, you know, my task. I think I have to tell all the pieces of the story, and that's what I try to do when I look at this. You know, then you say that fascism moved many people to Istria. You're right, but then you say that many people lived there for centuries. That's yes, support. My grandpa fought in the First World War with the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and he couldn't speak one word of German. He was Italian. He considered himself Italian. He was from Fiume. He lived there, and so, but the people lived there for centuries. They, you know, related to Venetian Republic, they spoke. They didn't even speak Italian, honestly. They speak a dialect, so they're very strong, very Venetian, that very eradicated. So they spoke this dialect, and that's what they done this for centuries. So they lived, people, Italians, let's say Italians, lived there for centuries. So that proves that why these people ran away. Suddenly, I mean, if they lived there for centuries, why, if my grandpa fought the First World War, why suddenly he decided to leave everything? Something happened, maybe. We know that this happened. Is this responsibility of the del Partito Comunista Italiano? Well, I don't say that, but I know for sure that's not the point. That you are right. We know. We read the letters. You can see many letters epistolari between Togliatti and Bianchi, a communist of the Partito Comunista della Venezia, della Friuli, and they say, okay, I spoke with Stalin, I think this, I think that. So, I mean, it's a chain of command. We know how it works. I mean, we know how it works. If you read the paper, we know how it works. So they started, and suddenly when in 48 they broke with Stalin's, you know, Stalin was accused by Tito to be too much nationalist. He said, no, your communist is not good. You're too much nationalist. That's what they accused. And so they broke. And suddenly, the position... it was written. It's not. It may be complicated, but not what it's written. Maybe there were reasons beneath. I agree with you. But you know, things are always complicated, and so I don't know. It's a very anyway. It's a complex. I think it's what is. It's right. Try to tell the story, or to tell what happened. Trying to understand all the fragments, the parts, but to tell what happened, and because you know it was negated for decades, that people were killed and put into the foiba. You couldn't say that.
It's all new. Outside of this specific area, you know, I mean, it's not part of Italian history that we learn beyond the borders of Italy, for example. There are a number of things beyond the borders of Italy we don't learn, or even within the borders of Italy we don't learn when it comes to things like emigration and things of that sort, right? So, but I mean, this is something I think we need to explore more. And just from the interviews that we did about 5 or 6 years ago, it was a whole, just from the 5 people we interviewed, there were all these facts that came out that we had absolutely no idea. The dangers in leaving, the way they had to leave, hiding in tanks, in steel crates, putting chloroform and all sorts of dye on their bodies so the dogs at the borders couldn't smell the human bodies and things of that sort, you know. And then, of course, later with someone like Bastianich, who comes over in the 50s, so that type of, those dramatic types of exodus weren't as popular, but they couldn't, a family couldn't leave. So, and as Bastianich tells it, her father left. The family stayed behind. Someone had to stay behind to make sure that the family wouldn't leave. And at a certain point, they were able to leave. But it wasn't easy, right? It wasn't easy. So it's a whole story we don't know about.
How important it is for us not to forget, not just the large displacements of Italians, but the smaller ones. And I think what you were saying, there's always an explanation for it. There's always a political explanation of it. And it's the people who pay for political machinations or solve national problems. It's the mass of people. So perhaps when you're talking about world history, we should be talking about it from that perspective, how the people pay, and they're doing it today too. And so when we talk about impacting the national discourse in Italy, that's how we should be impacting it as well. You know, that just like the North Africans, just like the Sub-Saharans, it continues. And it happened to us, and it's happening to others today. And we need to make those connections. We need to make those connections specifically.
I think that's true. And I think what Italo is saying is I teach Eastern European history, and everything you've said is, I think, is very accurate. The difficulty is that the people who lived that experience often can't talk about it as calmly as we can. Because in the case of Tito, he was the only Eastern European leader who won, whose party won government through a successful campaign against the fascists. And so that makes the whole Yugoslav experience really different from every other experience, whether it be Poland or whether it be Hungary or anywhere else across Eastern Europe. And so that affects the way in which the minorities in these places begin to understand themselves and their location in history. I must say, when I use oral history to interview people, I'm astonished sometimes at just how quickly they're taken back to these moments. I remember interviewing a woman, I did a book on Treviso. I was interviewing a woman who had been, who was smuggling stuff for the resistance in Treviso out of that. She made a boyfriend out of one of the German officers and, you know, got stuff out of Treviso. And I asked her to she thought I was saying, would you kneel for me? And she knelt for me in the middle of the interview. That was a scary moment because she was going right back to a moment in 1943, like that, you know. She was taken straight back in the process of talking about it. And you realise that these experiences people go through are just so visceral. They're so so we look at Indigenous cultures, we're seeing the transmission of this trauma across generations. In Australia, we have a huge problem with drugs and alcohol and other kinds of issues with our Indigenous Australians. And as white Australians, we're pretty bad at reconciliation. But what we have done is set up a process of a transmission of that suffering or that pain across generations. And you can actually see the bits of Australia where the frontier war was at its most severe are the same bits of Australia where we see these issues today. And it's a sort of a, it's been called a it's sort of a trail of tears, yeah. And you see it with Jewish friends too. You know, you interview Jewish friends about their family's experiences during the Holocaust. These people who weren't even alive then, who've got this transmitted, this inherited trauma. And it's really scary.
We're caging children today.
Oh, yeah.
And well, we know the effect that's
Yeah. In Australia, we're copying from us. We're putting kids on islands in the Pacific because the richer we get in Australia, the stupider we get and the more selfish we get. And it makes me angry. Yeah.
We have one more. Hold on. You need the microphone. Hold on.
I'm sorry. I'm not used to speaking in a microphone. What were you sharing with her, or what was she sharing with you that she thought?
I fell on her knees.
I'm confused.
I was asking her questions about how she negotiated with the Germans, who were then in charge of Treviso after 43, and got stuff out via the owner of the local cigar factory, and she said something about begging him or something. And I said, what do you mean? I forgot exact sequence of events, but she literally dropped on her knees in a kind of a surrender. Her body performed an action which was took her back. She was took back to that moment in time. This is like 60 years later. This is a long time, 50 years later. And she's taken like that, back to that moment. And that's the power of oral history. It's why we have ethics committees at universities now to control what we ask people. And it's just really important that we ask the questions in a way that's attentive to those issues, especially with Indigenous cultures.
We have one more question over here.
Thank you. Bob, if I may, my question was if you could talk a little bit more about the tough boys or tough guys.
Yep.
From your talk, I don't think you explained enough.
No, I had it. We have a very tough chair here. He cut everything out, the good bits out. It's his fault. Yeah, I wanted to go on and talk a bit about it because it's really important to me to understand adolescent Italian culture in its various manifestations. basically the tough guy idea in North American culture is unusual, and it's picked up in Hollywood, and it's there in Taxi Driver, it's there in a whole range of different manifestations, and it comes, I think it comes out of the Birmingham School talked about. The Birmingham School, if you remember back in the 70s, people like Stuart Hall said that what these kids were doing, he used to think of youth movements, it looks at the Teddy Boys in Britain, we look at we have the Sharpies and Bodgers in Australia, you have the Zoot Suit Boys in LA in the 40s. What they're doing, according to these theorists from the Birmingham School, and it fits with Deleuze and Guattari as well, is they are adopting what's often called a magical solution to a problem. They're caught in a very strict cultural contradiction. They have parents who've come from Italy and have come with a culture that's intact. They know who they are as members of a town near Palermo. They have a very strong sense of who they are. They don't transmit that culture to their kids because they can't, for a whole lot of reasons we discussed in a session this morning. The kids, the second generation, doesn't get that stuff. The second generation simply knows that they're not happy, that there is a discordance between who they might be in terms of what their parents are and who they might become as Americans. And they're caught between these two identities. And so it's not a complex thing to understand. The question is, how do they resolve it? And one of the ways they resolve it is that they take on a persona. And for young men, the persona of the tough guy is a very easy way out into it. And so it picked up in Hollywood. So Hollywood sifts and sorts the stuff out and makes money out of doing it. And so the Fonz character in Happy Days is a classic. So he has magical powers. And he says in one episode, you've only got to hit a man once, and everyone knows. And we're never shown that moment of violence that it does on the poor, innocent, white, middle-class kids that he mixes with, but they know he's a tough guy, and so they don't touch him. So he's got a sort of a shamanic power. He's a shaman. He's got this power over other kids. And that kind of power is what's aspired to by the North End toughs. And we have a whole lot of stuff written by social workers, because North End attracts the interest of people in the 20s and 30s, who talk about these young adolescents and talk about their culture. And what they're doing is, those kids are doing, they're playing out a performance in order to be identified. And the same thing is true of some areas of urban black cultures in America. You can still see that today with the way which people perform. And rap music in some ways is a kind of a version of that. In some ways, jazz is a version of that. Begins as a transgressive act. In some ways, rhythm and blues begins as a transgressive act in the Deep South. And so what America's really good at, and why it's the most successful culture of all time, is it's really good at taking what I call the Harlem, Harvard, Hollywood triangle. So it's Harlem represents the community. It's going to be to produce this new stuff, which is original, which is autochthonous. It's produced in America. It's not Italian. It's Italo-American. Hollywood takes it and takes the folk culture, takes these elements and makes them into something that's academically interesting and useful, and systematizes and puts it into theories and boxes, and then what Hollywood does is Hollywood massifies it. Hollywood takes it, once it's been valorized by either local level or by Harvard, the academic industry that Anthony represents, so that's the industry that controls the thinking of America, then once Hollywood takes it, they then make a buck out of it. So you could use lots of examples. You could use Pinocchio. You could use Aladdin as a good example. You could use that recent film that's about the Polynesian princess. What's it? Moana. Thank you, Moana. Classic example. Rip some indigenous culture out. Give it a twist. Give it a twist of feminism. Sell it. And so Hollywood's really powerful at that. And that's why America survives so well, because it takes its problems. So the North End tough guy is a problem. He's a problem to social workers. He's a problem to social science. He's a problem all over. But he's made into something by this process of reworking, and then Hollywood turns him into Al Pacino, or into, So it's all over.